The marriage of the composite bow, archer, and the horse produced the war chariot and charioteer, which transformed war in the Fertile Crescent. We know that the war chariot was the arm of decision, that is to say, the weapon system that was the biggest factor in deciding a battle's outcome for hundreds of years, and that this was very definitely the case by the 13th century BCE, when it was used by the important powers in the Fertile Crescent. But where did this innovation come from? Answering this question gives us a chance to look at how historians of the ancient world used to the utmost the limited evidence available to them, most of it the result of archaeological excavation. This is a bas-relief of a Hittite war chariot found in the ruins of Carchemish in present-day Turkey in 1913. In 1913, this area was part of the Ottoman Empire. The two archaeologists in the photo are T.E. Lawrence at left and Leonard Woolley at right. They were not just archaeologists. Lawrence and Woolley were apparently working for British naval intelligence and monitoring the construction of Germany's Berlin to Baghdad railway. Both served in the British Army during World War I. Woolley was captured by the Ottomans and spent most of the war as a POW. But T.E. Lawrence would go on to become world famous as Lawrence of Arabia, the British major who led Bedouin Arabs in a classic guerrilla campaign against the Ottomans. After the war, Woolley gained fame of his own as a pioneer in modern archaeology, particularly his supervision of the extensive excavations at Ur in present-day Iraq. In 1927-1928, Woolley discovered this object, which he found in a royal grave lying close to the shoulder of a man who may have held it on a pole. Woolley interpreted the object as a standard, which is to say, a visual symbol carried to denote someone important, and the man as the standard bearer. This interpretation is now thought unlikely, but the name has stuck. The standard, so-called, is a hollow wooden box measuring 8.5 inches wide by 19.5 inches long, inlaid with a mosaic of shell, redstone, red limestone, and lapis lazuli, a deep blue semi-precious stone. It has two sides, popularly called the war side and the peace side. You're looking at the peace side. This is the war side. The top two rows mainly show soldiers carrying spears and axes and protected by heavy cloaks instead of shields, but it has a four-wheeled cart at top left. The bottom row shows four such carts drawn by donkeys. The Sumerians did not have horses. And here is a detail of one such cart. As with two out of three of the other carts on this row, it shows a prostrate man beneath the donkeys. The cart itself contains two men, a driver and a man wielding a spear. Military historian Doyne Dawson interprets the scene as, quote, ass carts charging over the bodies of the enemy dead, which is probably all they ever did in battle. In a purely tactical sense, he's probably right. Experiments with reconstructed war carts showed that they were too heavy, too slow, and too awkward to maneuver to have been of much use on a battlefield. But other historians think that he misses an important point. The animal-vehicle harness combination was expensive, so few could afford it, and it lifted its rider above the battlefield. The military effectiveness of the war cart may even have resided, therefore, in a cultural perception of the cart as the conveyor of divine power. One's arrival on the battlefield literally meant the approach of a godlike enemy. That's as may be, but how do you get from an expensive prestige vehicle to the two-wheeled war chariot, the most lethal, militarily effective vehicle of the ancient world? And how is it that our earliest evidence for such a chariot comes from a grave at Sintashta, an archaeological site in Central Asia, first excavated in the 1970s, which is about 2,500 miles from ancient Sumer? Using radiocarbon dating, archaeologists have placed this grave at 2000 BCE. The earliest Near Eastern depiction of a war chariot dates from at least a century later, and more likely two. Now, before moving on, I'd like you to take a closer look at this chariot grave. The chariot itself has long disappeared, but we see the wheel imprints at right. We see the support posts that are designated. We see the charioteer. We see two horse skulls and lower limbs, one at the upper left-hand corner of the diagram and one at the right-hand corner. We see a knife. We see flint javelin points. So no one has ever been in any doubt that this is the grave of a charioteer. And in that part, at Sintashta and another nearby site, there are numerous other such chariot graves as well. Well, here's what we think happened to take an innovation that obviously came from Central Asia and find out how it transferred itself to other parts of the world. Well, donkeys lacked the size, speed, and power to pull a war chariot effectively. The war chariot therefore depended upon the availability of horses, who were plentiful mainly on the Central Asian steppes, which is to say grassy plains. Originally hunted for meat, the domestication of horses began when pastoralists, that is to say herders of animals, saw the advantages of herding horses for subsistence. Unlike cattle, horses could forage them for themselves during the winter, using their hooves to dig through the snow to find grass. This domestication of horses for meat would have bred them simultaneously for tameness and size. And within a few hundred years, these same horses were being ridden. This new population of mobile pastoral nomads traded with the cultures of the Fertile Crescent and adopted metal goods and metalworking technology from cities in Mesopotamia, present-day Iran, and the Indus River Valley, trading copper and tin for finished bronze products. Remember, it's copper and tin put together, an alloy of copper and tin that makes bronze. So not only were they trading copper and tin for finished bronze products, in the process, they were becoming familiar with these Mesopotamian cultures. They would immediately have seen the advantage of the four-wheeled Sumerian cart for carrying cargo, and soon after, spurred by the need to fight the increasingly common battles with other nomads that we know from archaeological evidence was taking place at this time, they invented a two-horse chariot pulled by horses that were fast enough and agile enough to make an effective platform for archers. War chariots were so effective, in fact, that knowledge of the new technology and its adoption as a military tool rapidly spread from central to eastern Asia and, by 1700 BCE, westward as far as Egypt. They were expensive, and therefore, even for the steppe inventors, were a source of prestige. One archaeologist has written that chariots were supreme advertisements of wealth, difficult to make and requiring great athletic skill and a team of specially trained horses to drive. They were available only to those who could delegate much of their daily labor to hired herders. A chariot was proof that the driver was able to fund a substantial alliance or was supported by someone who had the means. Further, the chariot required an archer skilled enough to shoot arrows rapidly and accurately from the chariot while it was maneuvering at top speed. On top of that, we estimate that each chariot probably required at least half a dozen men, a carpenter and metal worker to maintain the chariot, a bowyer responsible for the composite bow and its arrows, a groom to care for the horses, and a driver and archer to man the chariot in battle. But if the main form of warfare during that period was the defense or besiegement of cities, how were war charioteers useful? Well, sieges depended upon lots of infantry, spearmen and archers who marched to the site of the siege. And a city could most easily defend itself by halting such an enemy before it could reach the city. In a chariot versus infantry encounter, chariots would have terrified untrained conscripts, and even against trained infantry, could drive up within bowshot of the enemy, launch a flight of arrows, withdraw out of range when necessary or desirable, and then repeat this tactic. In a chariot versus chariot encounter, chariots would likely have stood off from one another, circling in place, and when possible, loosing arrows at each other, generally in an indecisive way, but probably enough that they often stopped ground troops from continuing their march toward the targeted city. Now, to get a better idea of the war chariot as a military technology, watch the following two videos. Then watch the third video providing an overview of the Battle of Kadesh in May 1274 BCE, fought between the Egyptians and the Hittites, a people from present-day Turkey. Finally, and importantly, I want you to read the case study on the Battle of Kadesh found in World History of Warfare on pages 14 through 19.